Thank you, Brent. And let me first thank the organizer for putting all this work to organize this nice trimester in Bonn. It's really nice to be here. And thanks also for inviting me to give this talk. So today I will discuss about analytical properties for surfactors. And we have seen many talks already on those analytical properties for reduced state-start tensor categories. And here I will present the original approach due to Popa in the 90s for properties such as amenability, Hoyer-Root property, and property T. And I will also present weak amenability. So I will start very slowly by present you, just talk a bit about surfactors with few examples, and then talk about the symmetric open inclusion, which is sort of quantum double of surfactors, and then I will give you some more recent results. Okay, so let's start slowly, as I was saying. Whoop. Okay, so a bit more slowly. So the Jones theory of surfactors get birth roughly in 83 with a seminal paper on those surfactors. And so here the context I want to look at is you need an inclusion of 2-1 factors. There is also a lot of study in type 3, and here I will just stay in type 2-1. And so in 83, a very nice quantity that was introduced was the index, which is just the dimension of L2 of M as a n by module, as a n module, sorry. And so for me, all the example will be, in order to develop the technology, will be such that the index is finite, which is the same thing that saying that M is a n module which is finitely generated. Okay. So there is really a lot of examples, so let me present some key one that will be sort of the leading example for looking at approximation properties, analytical properties. So the first one, which is sort of the baby case, is with finite groups. So you can consider a 2-1 factor M and a finite group G, and we let it act out early on M. Well, what happens is that the fixed point is going to be still a factor, and so the inclusion gives you a subfactor. Okay. And so here, the index is going to be just the order of the group, but this one is going to be sort of trivial in terms of analytical properties, because the analytical properties of these subfactors will be the same than the one of the group. So since I want to look at things of such as amenability, Hoyer-Root property, things like that, it will have all the property you could imagine. Okay. So a more interesting example for this purpose is to look at the so-called diagonal surfactors that was introduced by Popa, if I'm right. So you consider a group G, which is finitely generated and once again intact out early on a 2-1 factor N. And so you look at this diagonal inclusion right here, when if you want the element of this factor, each entry on the diagonal will be twisted by one element by those generator of your group. Okay? And you look at it in your factor tensorized with all the matrices. Okay. So you get a nice subfactor once again, and the index is n plus 1 square. So you can easily guess the index if you had only trivial element right here. And what we'll see is that these subfactors will remember many analytical properties of your group G. And this is really the motivation. One nice way to look at subfactors is to imagine that all kinds of subfactors are sort of generalization of that when the symmetries of the subfactor is not given by a group but something slightly more general. So these surfactors behave very well. However, it's not it's reducible, so it's not irreducible, but it's still extremal. So it's still a nice feature. And so there's also another surfactor that kind of removes the reducibility problem, which is the so-called Bisch-Hoyer-Root surfactors. So what it is, well, you look at a group G, which is generated by two finite groups, H and K. And once again, it acts nicely on a 2-1 factor N. And you consider these subfactors, which is sort of a composition of two subfactors like that. Okay? So So you look at the fixed point for H inside the semi-direct product with respect to K. And you still have a list of surfactors, and your index is just the product of the order of the groups. And this time, it's actually irreducible. And as we will see, these surfactors will as well remember all the analytical properties, let's say, properties that you can define with positive definite function or completely bounded function. These surfactors will remember them, the one of the group. And so there are other constructions that were made in other contexts. So for example, with compound groups, that was due to Wasserman. And as we saw the other day in the talk of James, also with conformal nets, and this was due to Jones and Wasserman. Okay. And of course, there are a plethora of very exotic subfactors that have, for example, that appeared in this very successful program of classification of small index subfactors. But they are generally of finite depth, and so they don't really fit inside what I want to talk about today. All right, so let me just recall briefly what the standard invariant is and how it's related to those, all those tensor categories we've been talking about so far. So what you do to do the standard invariant, that's something that appears in the very first paper of Jones in 83 on the subject, is that you look at this bimodule, this NM bimodule, and then you perform all kind of tensor product with it, with this one, and also with contra gradient. Okay. And you get bunch of bimodule, and between them you look at the bimodular map, so all the intertwiner space, if you want. And you obtain a lattice of finite dimensional sister algebras with those intertwiner space. That's what is called the standard invariant. And so this is sort of behave like a group, so it's kind of a group-like object. And you have like two very important, very nice piece of information that you want to remember, depending on what you want to do. And one of them is this pair of categories. So you can look at the category generated by L2 of M as an N bimodule, or also L2 of M1 as an M bimodule, where M1 is a basic construction of N inside M. Right. And so those categories have all the nice properties that you can imagine. They are what is called a rigid C-star tensor categories, and that's the one that those are key examples that we saw, for example, in the talk of Sergei. All right. And so what we'll see is that when you define properties for C, it's going to be the same than the property you get for the subfactors in the original approach due to Popper. Another piece of information is those pair of graphs, the principal and dual graph, and that's something which is, for example, very used in classification of small index surfactors, when you can actually, you try to remove all the graphs that cannot appear as a principal graph of surfactors. Okay. And so these standard invariants have been, as we saw in the talk of Zheng Wei, axiomatized in three different ways during the previously. So the first axiomatization is due to Hockney and Anu, which is called the paragroup, and it was actually only work for finite depths. And then the general case arrived later with the work of Soren Popa with the lambda lattices. And then even later on, Jones gave a new axiomatization in terms of planar algebra. And that, as you can see, it's something which is also related to other topics. So those three axiomatizations are very complementary with each other, which is very nice, is that each of them is different and give you a new attack to look at subfactor theory. All right. And so here I'm talking about abstract characterization, description of this standard invariant. And we know it is total thanks to the work of Soren Popa, because any abstract standard invariant can be realized by a subfactor. So that was a very important result to have in the theory. And nonetheless, using some free probability theory, you can actually see that you can always realize these subfactors when N and M has LF infinity, when F infinity is a free group factor with infinitely many generators. Okay. So So here I'm not talking about uniqueness of realization. It sort of only makes sense to talk about uniqueness when you look at hyperfinite subfactors, but there are also results about it, but there are also many open questions on that. I should just cite that when you are finite depths, there's always a unique realization. And actually, there's always a unique realization when you are amenable. Okay, and this is also due to Popa. Okay. So let's see. Okay. So now the key tool I want to look for my subfactors to associate it to it in order to look at approximation properties is a so-called, well, it has many names actually, but let's call it the symmetric open inclusion, the SEI. And so I'm not going to define precisely what it is, but I'm going to give you the key properties of this inclusion and also give you some key examples. All right, so we start with subfactors, and we associate a new inclusion inside S. And so this inclusion, well, once again, there've been various group of people who works on it, and Okneanu get this idea of looking at this sort of quantum double of your subfactors, but in the restricted case of finite depth hyperfinite subfactors. And in this case, actually, the construction is much simpler. But for this purpose, it was really, really nice. And then after, they were kind of independently, if I understood correctly, research on having this quantum double, and Longo Rehwang gave one in the context of finite depth type 3 factors, so more for conformal nets. And at the same time, so in Popa gave a construction for any case, meaning for any depth for type 2, and actually it works as well for type 3. And Mazuta later on shows that actually all those constructions coincide on their restricted area. So they are, it's really the same object. Okay, so what it is really, what are the properties of this inclusion? Well, first, your T is nothing else than the tensor product of your big factor M with this opposite. Okay. And your S is going to be, so it's going to be a 2-1 factor. And your S is going to be generated by T and a Jones-like projection. And what is very nice is that actually both S is going to be as well a 2-1 factor, and the inclusion is irreducible subfactors. So meaning that the relative commutant of T inside S is going to be trivial. It's going to be the complex number. And none of that, more than that, it's also a quasi-regular inclusion. So this means that when you decompose S as a T bimodule, you will have a bunch of bifinite bimodule. And that's something which is very nice and which is very close to a cross-product decomposition, a cross-product inclusion, if you want. So more precisely, and that's really what you want for a generalization of quantum double in form of algebra, then when you look at L2 of S and you decompose it in irreducible bimodule, well, you get exactly all the irreducible bimodule that appears in the Jones tower. They appear exactly once, and they are tensor with their opposite. Okay. So that's a very, very nice thing. So if you want, if you look at the category, if you look at all the bimodule here, they are closed under tensor product, so it's you already have the whole category right there. You don't need to do any basic construction or anything like that. And so in particular, you get that the index of these new subfactors is a global index of your subfactor that you started with. So if you want the global index of your category of M bimodule. Right. And so in particular, these subfactors will have finite index if and only if these little subfactors have finite depths. Okay. All right. And so immediately, well, okay, let me stop. Yeah. We'll see that if we want nice properties, interesting analytical properties for this inclusion, well, we'll necessarily need that these small subfactors inside them have infinite depths. One very motivating example for looking at analytical properties come from, again, from the diagonal subfactors of Popa. And what you get is that the SEI is literally the cross product by the group you started with. And so once you see this example, you understand that if you look at this guy and relative properties with respect to T, you expect to get all the properties you could imagine from your group G. Well, when I say all properties, I mean reasonable properties for us, meaning like more like things that you define with completely positive or completely bounded maps. Okay. And also, when you look at the SEI for a Bisch-Heurup subfactor, you don't get exactly a cross product like that, but almost. So here I'm a bit vague with the notation, but what the thing is that if you look at H inside G, this is an almost normal subgroup, it's a Hecke pair of groups, and you can define an action of these Hecke pairs on n tensor n. And the cross product, if you want, is the algebra I put here, and that contain, which contains this subalgebra. So it's almost, if you want, a cross product decomposition with respect to the Hecke pair H inside G. What you have. And so once you see this schema, you sort of, you can be easily convinced that the analytical properties of G will be the same than these subfactors. Okay. That's this inclusion. All right. Oop. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so let's look at analytical properties. Let me give you the original strategy, or at least for property T and Heurup property. Actually, for amenability, there were many ways to define it for subfactors and standard invariant. And that was done by Popa, and there is maybe more than 15 characterizations. But nevertheless, I will put them in the same bag for here. So it was done for amenability, property T, and Heurup property in the 90s by Sorin Popa. And what I did by mimicking the approach of Sorin Popa, so all of those properties I defined with completely positive maps, I could define the notion of weak amenability and complete metric approximation properties for subfactors. And the difference is that here you deal with completely bounded maps. So the Popa strategy is that you start with your subfactors inside M. You look at your symmetric and open inclusion. Okay, and then you look at relative properties of this SEI. That's what you do. And then you decrete your subfactor as this property if this inclusion has a relative, corresponding relative property. I'm going to give the precise definition in the next slide, but I just want to give you the strategy right here. And so the very nice thing, very nice result, is that you can show that those three properties, well, they only depend on the standard invariant of your subfactors. So even though you define them for your specific subfactors, actually they only depend on the standard invariant. And that's also what led to all those nice theory for rigid state tensor categories. When you define directly for them some analytical properties. And also you can do it for the standard line. Okay. And so as I was saying, with a similar proof, you can show that the weak amenability only depends also of the standard invariant. So you don't really care of your ambient subfactors. You only care about the standard invariant. And the nice thing here is that you could also take the subfactors you prefer to look at in order to deduce analytical properties. All right, and as we saw in many talks before, there have been three different approach to look at those properties. And the first one arrived with the work of Popa and Vass for rigid state state tensor categories. And shortly after, there was this very different approach due to Sagan HBF and Makoto Yamashita, and also by Kumar Ghosh and Corey Jones. Okay, when you define directly for the category, and also in the work of Popa Vass, you also define directly for the standard invariant, and you kind of see why you can deduce just from the category to the standard invariant. Okay. All right, so let's look at the weak amenability, how you defined it. So let me just recall what it is for a discrete group. It has been defined originally for locally compact group, but for this purpose, I will just give you the definition in this case. So you consider the group G, and you say it is weakly amenable if there exists a sequence of functions from G to C, a multiplier, so that they have finite support, and also they are uniformly bounded for the CB norm, and they converge pointwise to one. Okay. So this tells you that you are weakly amenable. And if I replace here this condition by saying Fn is positive definite, well, this will be an equivalent definition of amenability. That's why we talk about weakly. It's really a weakening of amenability. And what you have attached to any weakly amenable group is a constant called the Kolin-Hoyle group constant. And what it is, well, you look at all the sequence Fn that do the job, and you look at the infimum of this quantity, this lipsum of Fn. And this is this constant, this Kolin-Hoyle group constant. And so, for example, if you are amenable, this constant will be always equal to 1. But there is some example of non-amenable group when this constant is 1. Okay. And we say that you have C-map if this constant is 1. So that's a complete metric approximation property. Yeah. OK, so let's look at a few examples. So, well, first, as I was saying, all amenable groups are like that. And then, more interestingly, all the free groups also, the free groups are weakly amenable. And this is due to Hoyle group. And this is, there is like an amazing work that has been done by Kolin and Hoyle group when they show that actually lattices in simple Lie groups of real rank 1, well, they are all weakly amenable. And actually, they manage to compute explicitly the constant for any of those lattices, which is really remarkable. And you see that as soon as you are higher rank, well, the constant will be infinite. So you are no longer weakly amenable. Okay. And then after this very beautiful paper due to Ozawa, when he showed that any hyperbolic group is actually weakly amenable. And what is very interesting with those two results is that, well, you get some property T group. So here, for example, with lattices in SPN1, and also there's many hyperbolic groups that have property T. Well, you see that they are as well weakly amenable. So the class of weakly amenable groups contain many, many different kind of groups. Yeah. And you might wonder if they are all weakly amenable. Well, there are some counterexamples. So if you, okay. So yeah, there's this result due to Ozawa and Popa that tell you that if you do some rough product, well, you can go outside of the class of weakly amenable. Yeah. And that's a typical example, I would say, when you go outside of this class. Yeah. So it also shows you, because look, they are very nice group, both of them. You have an abelian group and something which is with CMAP. Well, nevertheless, you go outside. Yeah. So the
first example actually was used by the group back in 1986.
Ah, okay. Okay. Wait, and it's true. I just said that also the higher rank Lie groups, they go outside, yeah. Okay. But thank you, yeah. All right, so let's do it now for some factors, and you will see that the. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I forgot that. Yeah. I see. Yeah, because at some point, many people, I mean, it was not clear if the Hoyle group with the Hoyle group property and the weakly amenable group with constant one were the same class, actually. And it's quite amazing that it took, I mean, it shows that it's a highly non-trivial problem that it took many times, actually, to show that they are not the same. Yeah. Okay, so let's now look at the weak amenability for subfactors. And so, as you can see, the definition is quite straightforward. So you look at your subfactors and look at this SEI, and you will decrease that it's weakly amenable if you have a sequence of maths that are normal, T by modular, and so that the image is bifinite T by module. So it means that this is the equivalent of finitely supported. Then you have this uniform bound on the CB norm, so as in the group case. And they converge pointwise for the norm too. And so what you get is that, as in the group case, all amenable subfactors are weakly amenable. So this is sort of obvious by one characterization of amenability of POPA for subfactors. And you can show by adapting, this is more like by adapting the group case that it's going to be closed under tensor product. And then what is non-trivial is that actually, if you do a free product in the sense of Bisch-Jones of amenable subfactors, well, it is still weakly amenable. And actually, in the group case, Ricard and Xu, they prove this very nice result that when you do the free product of CMAP group, so weakly amenable with constant one, well, it's still weakly amenable with constant one. But actually, this result is far from being obvious in the for any phenomenon algebra, because even in the case of free product of trivial phenomenon algebra with CMAP, we don't know if it is still CMAP. So it's still open. And so here you have a similar phenomena that appears for the subfactors, because here you deal with amalgamated free product for the SEI. And so I could only prove it for this case. However, there were a generalization of this result due to Popa and Vass by looking at the in the category context when you could relax slightly the hypothesis here. So by putting CMAP with an additional property, it means that you behave well with the L2 norm, roughly, for your CB maps. You could still show that the free product is weakly amenable. Okay. But still today, it is open to know if free product of CMAP have CMAP here. Okay. And so let me just end here by some few results. So as I was saying, when you look at the diagonal subfactors, as we saw the SEI, semi-direct product decomposition, you will immediately get this result that the, all the analytical properties of amenability, Heuro property, weak amenability and property T, well, that they are the same than the subfactors. Okay. And this comes really from the decomposition. And then you can do it also for the Bisch-Heuroub case, when we saw there was this kind of decomposition with respect to Ecke pair. Well, so the first one was for amenability. It was due to Bisch and Heuroub. Then Bisch and Popa did it for property T, and you can literally adapt this proof for the Heuroub case. And then I did it for the weak amenability case, where you actually recover exactly the same coiling Hagerup constant here. You get the same thing. And then there is this very famous subfactor that we saw in the last talk of Zhengwei, which is a TLJ subfactor for temporary Lipp-Jones subfactors. And so this was proved by Popa and Vass that actually this subfactor has CMAP, so it's weakly amenable with constant one, and also has a Heuroub property. And this proof, if you want, was kind of in two steps. So there was this work of, very nice work of Decomer, Frelon, and Yamashita, when they show that the quantum group SUQ2 always have those two properties. Okay. And those central properties as quantum groups. And so it means that the representation category of SUQ2 has those properties, as explained Yuki Arano during his talk. And so with this nice theory of Popa-Vass that was able to define those properties for those categories, they could by noticing that the category of TLJ is almost the same as the representation category of SUQ2, they could transfer this result from quantum groups and show that the TLJ subfactors have CMAP and has the Royal property. And then, in a work in common with Von Jones, we gave a new proof of the fact that TLJ has a Royal property using the original approach of Sorin Popa, using the original definition, which is with the symmetric and open inclusion. And we did it by choosing a very nice realization of the SEI, which was a work in common of Alice Guionet, Dima Shatenko, and Von Jones, and also Steve Curran. And using a representation theory, another one due to Von, the annular representation, we could construct a bunch of bimodules over this SEI that give us many UCP maps, and we're able to show the whole group property in that way. So it was a very purely planar algebraic proof that used as well a previous representation theory due to Von. Okay. And then more recently, I've been looking at the action of groups on locally finite trees. And with those actions, you can construct, in some case, some subfactors and some categories. And what I did here is really that I describe precisely the symmetric and open inclusion of those subfactors. And as an application, I was able to show that if you start with something amenable, well, you stay amenable. Okay. So factors you end up with this action on your tree is going to be still amenable. And from a much more general framework, Arano and Vass were able to show many this result and many other but analytical properties of subfactors constructed in that way. Okay. So that's basically all I would like to talk with, so thanks for your attention. Yeah.
Is there anything similar in the subfactor model?
So far, it doesn't exist, but yeah, you're not the first one who asked this question. And not. I mean, so far, all those properties that I was saying, they are defined with completely positive and completely bounded maps. So I don't know if it is so clear that we can define for these so-called approximation properties of Royal Open Cross.
Thank you. I have a question for your last bit of, do you think this is conceivable to have for amenable actions instead of amenable groups?
For this?
Yeah.
Well, so actually, in the framework of Arano and Vass, you really see what you need to have that it works. Yeah. And so you really look closely, I mean, by the dynamic of your action. And that will give you a bit how it looks like the category. However, you always get rep G, which should be inside the category. So you will have, if your group don't act in a reasonable way, most part of the time it's not gonna stay amenable. If you have a big group which is not amenable. Yeah, that's right. And I mean, what is nice with this new thing is that before it was always with groups. You see, with the Bichat group, well, you get echo pairs of groups, sort of. And here, basically, we have a much more complicated dynamical system, I would say. And here, what you get is that when you look at the fixed point of one vertex, this will have a lot of properties of the echo pairs of the fixed point inside G. So that's really what you should look at, plus a bit of the dynamic. Yeah. And that's really the two pieces. Yeah. And when you look at the decomposition of this SEI, you have three algebras. And so A inside B inside C. And B inside C is exactly the information of the Ecke pairs of group I just talked with. And then the last pieces give you a bit of the dynamic. So that's really what's going on here. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is fine with me. But however, the, you know, the idea, the first one who verbally, I think, I don't think that it was Rippin who kind of launched this idea of where it was born. So one said at some point, well, you know, we cannot really expect for the standard invariant for, you know, to have to be a positive, I mean, to be one to one with subfactors in the hyperfinite case, because, you know, take a big group factor that takes the diagonal always actions of the big group because of the randomness and the multitude of actions of the group. It's impossible, they all have the same standard.
Oh, I see, okay.
So, however, so for many years, it's true that I did this was like a trademark for me because I kind of used, you know, translate this subfactor to translate problems and do analysis in subfactor context of, you know, actions of groups on the hyperfinite one.
I see. This key example, or
classify actions show equivalences, or well, so that I just want to make this comment that, you know, that I think the first time I heard that, probably even I think Born also mentioned to me once that it was Alan who gave him the idea of X value and
the function. Well,
okay, yeah.